Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. So good to see you here in this fall season as we continue to walk through so many of the beautiful Old Testament texts that we've shared throughout the fall. Actually, today's is really a wonderful passage. Looking forward to sharing that with you. Some announcements to bring to your attention. Oh, I have my stole on. I don't know where it is. Somebody stole my stole. Okay. Thank you. Getting dressed in the morning. Yellow cards are in the pew racks in front of you. If you could fill those out and place them in the offering tray when it comes by later this morning, we'd love to just know that you are here. If you have any communications with the office, that's a great way to do it. Trunk or Treat is coming up on the 27th. That's a Sunday. It's if you don't know what Trunk or Treat is, it adds to the festival of Halloween by us all gathering with treats in our trunks and disguises on our faces and bodies to share in the celebration of the Halloween season. So that happens in the afternoon here from 3:30 to 5 on the 27th. That's the last Sunday in October. If you want to team up with someone, or you just want to come and open your trunk in the parking lot for kids to walk by and share their scary faces, they would love that. The Rite of Affirmation is also coming up on that day, the 27th. We have four students prepared to affirm their faith in the midst of this congregation. It's at the 10:45 service. Wonderful celebration, wonderful expression of the faith that we hold dear, and to raise kids in the faith as a commitment of our body. The Big Umbrella conversation is happening next Sunday. So these conversations give us a context, a setting in which to share challenging but important conversations related to expressing faith in the civil discourse of our country. There may be more difficult questions, and this week we're talking about the state and identity of migrants in our community. Not necessarily our community as Americans dealing with a migration challenge, but what does the Bible have to say about hospitality or uncertainty regarding the stranger? And I'll tell you right now, they're both in there. And the wonderful thing about our Bible, our scripture, is that there's a dialogue going on inside of us, inside of the very book that we read. And God invites us into the dialogue. And so what we'll do is gather for a potluck next Sunday around 12:30. Come and we'll spend, it'll be, you know, the whole meeting will last about an hour and a half. But we'll look at some really significant scriptures about how to understand the relationship of people of faith belonging to the call of God and welcoming or understanding the migrant in our needs, in our midst. Today, you may be aware, there's a breakfast going on. And that's for Habitat. It's going on in the fellowship hall, and they have a video that, while not actually advertise the breakfast, it will advertise the significance of sharing in Habitat for Humanity and our congregation's long heritage of connection to it. So let's watch that video.
Audio over there. Audio. see. Come on back. Imagine that we could get it together and stand up for where we need to be. 'Cause crying won't save or feed a hungry child. Can't lay down and wait for a miracle to change things. So lift up your eyes, lift up your heart, singing, mercy, will we overcome this? Oh, one by one, could we turn it around? Maybe carry on just a little bit longer. And I try to give you what you need. Me and you and you and you, I just wanna be free, yeah, yeah. But you see, all the world is just as we've made it. And until we got a new world, I got to say that love is not a whisper or a weakness. No, love is strong. We got to get together, yeah. Gotta get. So there is no reason to fight. Mercy, will we overcome this? Yeah, one by one, could we turn it around? Maybe carry on just a little bit longer. And I'll try to give to me.
Let's stand together. And we'll prepare our hearts for worship with a word of confession and the assurance of God's forgiveness. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. I'll invite you to kneel as you are comfortably able. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a member of the Church of Christ and by Christ's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let's stand together and sing.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Be with you. Let us say together the prayer of the day. God who answers prayer, we are blessed and humble that you hear us when we call to you in time of deepest longing. Receive our gratitude for your listening ear. Amen. Please be seated. And this morning we're going to return to a tradition that we've had at St. Matthew that we've not done for a while, which is to sing the psalmody, and Chris will lead in that.
As soon as he gets a microphone that will work, yes.
Do you need?
Path of life, you
show me the path of life. Protect me, O God, for I take refuge in you. I have said to the Lord, you are my Lord, my good above all other. All my delight is in the godly that are in the land, upon those who are noble among the people. But those who run after other gods shall have their troubles multiplied. I will not pour out drink offerings to such gods, never take their names upon my lips. You will show me the path of life. O Lord, you are my portion and my cup. It is you uphold my lot. My boundaries enclose a pleasant land. Indeed, I have a rich inheritance. I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me night after night. I have set the Lord always before me. Because God is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. You will show me the path of life. My heart therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope, for you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the pit. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. You will show me the path of life.
Thank you, Chris. Took some effort, but it was worth it, I think. I'm going to invite the children to come up and join me up here. Ready for Halloween? All right. What are you going to be for Halloween? Where are you going to be for Halloween? You don't know yet. Okay. How about you, Ray? A what? Home? Okay. What are you going to dress up as? That's my question. So yeah. Who wants to tell me what they're going to dress up as? What do you got? An astronaut? Okay. Very good. Who's got it? Anyone else got plans? Alex? You're going to be what? Huggy Wuggy. I don't know what that is, but I'm so far out of it. I'm sorry. Yeah. What are you going to be? A ghost. Okay. Okay. Anyone else want to share what they're going to be on Halloween? No. A siren, like in Homer and the... No, siren. Oh, okay, sorry. Yes, right. It's in the Odyssey. Homer's the Odyssey. They sing and attract. Sorry. I don't know what's going on here. Am I right? Yes, I'm right. Right. Yeah. Okay. All right. The Odyssey. You should read it. It's a wonderful book. Very, very, very good. Your mom will tell you all about it, I'm sure. Yes. Where was I? Halloween, that's right. Do you guys, like Halloween? Is that a really, okay, an important celebration? Do you like being scared? Do you? Okay, now why? Why do you like being scared? Okay, it's an adrenaline rush. Okay. There's probably good places to be afraid and bad places to be afraid, right? What's a good place to be afraid? What do you think? Okay, you're with your friends, you're going through a haunted house, and you're anticipating being afraid, so when you are, you're like, accomplish that, right? Okay. Or, you know, do you like scary movies? Any of you like scary movies? So you're with your family, you're gathered on the couch watching a scary movie, but it's a movie, right? And you all know it's a movie. It's not real, right? What's a bad place to be afraid? What do you think? Danger, that's right. Maybe you're by yourself. And you don't know where your surroundings are. Yeah. What do you got? You got. What's that? Giant spiders crawling around. Okay. So you didn't anticipate it. You don't know what they're going to do or what they could do, and so that's right. That's when you're afraid. I think. The two qualities that make fear okay is community and belonging, you know, and the confidence that you're okay, right? You're safe, right? There's a text from the book of 1 John, and this is what it says. Oh my gosh. I got glasses out, sorry. Okay, I'm now ready to read. 1 John 4. Love has been perfected in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so we are in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment. Whoever has fear has not reached perfection. We love because we were first loved, right? So, knowing that God loves us, knowing that God recognizes value in us, knowing that God has given us a place of belonging and protection and great love, those are all places that give us the freedom to share scary moments and know it's just a moment, right? Oh, that's a pretty good place to be. Okay. And that's why we can celebrate Halloween. Scary things on a scary day because we know it's just a day. All right. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your faithfulness and your love for us. Thank you that we get the joy of sharing in scary moments and instead of being afraid, laughing and finding the joy in the adrenaline rush. Lord, we thank you for great love that gives us freedom to do that. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. All right. Thank you for coming up. Thank you for sharing your Halloween expectations.
Readings from 1 Samuel, the first and second chapters. After they had eaten and drunk at Shiloh, Hannah rose and presented herself before the Lord. Now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat beside the doorpost of the temple of the Lord. She was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She made this vow, O Lord of hosts, if only you will look on the misery of your servant and remember me, and not forget your servant, but will give to your servant a male child, then I will set him before you as a Nazarite until the day of his death. He shall drink neither wine nor intoxicants, and no razor shall touch his head. They rose early in the morning and worshipped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house at Ramah. Elkanah knew his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. In due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son. She named him Samuel, for she said, I have asked him of the Lord. Hannah prayed and said, My heart exults in the Lord. My strength is exalted in my God. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in my victory. There is no holy one like the Lord, no one beside you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly, and let not arrogance come from your mouth. The Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble gird on strength. Those who are full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who are hungry are fat with spoil. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low, he also exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the Lord, earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness, for not by might does one prevail. The Lord, his adversaries will be shattered. The Most High will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the power of his anointed. Here ends the reading. Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. Gospel according to St. Luke, the first chapter. And Mary said, My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
Okay. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. I want to spend some time just kind of giving us the landscape of where we're at in this narrative lectionary. We started preaching it on kickoff Sunday, and that means this is our sixth week of this sermon series, or the preaching through the narrative lectionary. And up till now, the first 5 weeks of this preaching year, we have been in the first two books of the Bible. We've been in Genesis and Exodus. Today, we find ourselves beginning a text from 1 Samuel. Clarifying, 1 Samuel is not next to Exodus, right? It's not even close to Exodus, really. We skipped seven books to get where we're at, and I wanted to kind of characterize that, because it's helpful if we're going to look at the body of Scripture to consider the sinews that kind of hold it together. And when you're skipping six books, there's a big gaping hole in your narrative. And it's helpful to remember and know that. It's also helpful for us as we look at the text we've been given, the story of Hannah, to set her in her context and understand how it is she speaks to us from her place. The six books that we've skipped, I should just say a little about that. It's not that those books are lacking in value. The first three books that we skipped are Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. That's the large majority of the books of the law, the Jewish books of the law. They call it the Torah. And the other three books that we skipped are right after that, right? Joshua, Judges, and Ruth. Three of those books, Deuteronomy and Joshua and Ruth, in the four-year cycle that we're preaching in the narrative lecture, we will give each of them 1 week. 1 week. The other three books do not appear in the preaching schedule at all. You might think to yourself, well, why is that, Pastor Jim? We're following the narrative lectionary, and we've just made a huge gaping hole in the narrative of the narrative lectionary. I guess what I want to say is, again, it's not that these books that get less attention in the preaching experience are unimportant. It's that they're very challenging in places and very complex in places. And so the best context for their consideration is in a setting where questions can be asked, and we can share a dialogue about them and examine how they're connected and how it is we understand those challenging elements of them. And anyone who's spent some time in Leviticus knows what that's about. That's a challenging book. It's not one that you curl up with and say, wow, this is a wonderful story. It's full of details that are difficult to set in their context. So that's what we skipped. Hannah now. Hannah begins the telling of 1 Samuel, and she does more than that. She begins the narrative about the kings of Israel, right? The kings in all of their stories appear in four books, 1 and 2 Samuel, and then 1 and 2 Kings. Hannah precedes all of them And she stands out in that context, right? The First and Second Samuel has three main characters in that book. There's Samuel. There is Saul, the first king of Israel, and there's David. And there are a whole slate of supporting actors, people like Nathan the prophet, like Abner and Joab, the generals, like Jonathan, the son of Saul and the friend to David. And what all of those characters that dominate the field in those two books have in common is they're all men, right? There are only about five or six women who speak in those two books, 1 and 2 Samuel. Three of them are wives to David. Bathsheba, in particular, speaks and has a place of prominence because of the scandal of how the relationship with David began. Tamar speaks. Tamar is David's daughter, who, like Bathsheba, is an individual who suffers at the hands of the men around her in the story. Hannah speaks in these first two chapters as the champion of her own story, right? And that makes her very unique in this text. But it's not only how Hannah precedes the story of the kings. The significance of her place is not just her prologue; it's how she follows the content of the book of Judges. Hannah is the connective tissue that connects the stories of the judges in the book of Judges and the kings in the books of 1 and 2 Samuel. Her son, Hannah's son Samuel, is the last of the judges, and he anoints the first two kings of Israel. Something else about that we should take account of when you consider her story as it completes the era of the judges, which again is a challenging book. It's why we don't preach it in the 4 years of the narrative lectionary. Challenging story. The judges themselves are mostly charismatic military leaders that God calls forward to serve a function of relieving the nation from some oppressor. That's typically the story that you get with Judges. There are two prominent women in the book of Judges. The first one is Deborah, who was one of the very first judges in the book of Judges. And she leads her nation with humility and integrity, and works to resolve the threat to her people. The other woman that appears is a woman who is the animating force in the final story in the book of Judges. She animates the story because she is the object of one of the most horrifying and violent acts anywhere in Scripture. Just think about that narrative line, right? The narrative line that now Hannah comes in to bridge from that horrible act to a new age. Hannah precedes the establishment of men in seats of unchecked power, and she follows the devolution of social cohesion that would make it so a woman could lead her nation at the beginning of the book, but a woman serves without name and without voice at the end of the book of Judges to become nothing more than the object of ungodly violence. So that's Hannah's place. That's her place in the story. This oasis of integrity and longing and humility and courage and faith in the midst of the chaos. I don't know about you, but I couldn't help but think of the Me Too movement that began a few years ago. When Me Too began, none of us were so naive as to believe that the absence of claims of abuse meant there were no abuses to claim. None of us believed that. We know what power does. We know the license that it offers to bullies and to predators. We didn't read this portion of the story, but right after the first short passage that we read in chapter 1 of Hannah's story, we hear about Eli, the high priest in Israel, who sees Hannah praying fervently in the tabernacle and notices that her lips are moving, but there is no sound coming out of her body. She is literally voiceless in that moment. And because he sees this incongruity in his estimation, he accuses her of drunkenness. And that's a poetic irony, I think. This voiceless woman praying in fervency, so overcome with longing and her petition to have a child, that the high priest makes the assumption that she is not in control of her faculties. But God hears her voice. God hears her prayers. And God answers her plea and gives to her a son. Many years ago, I preached a sermon on a similar passage, not this one, but a similar passage, and I summarized an important point to make about women in Scripture, and that is that there is a curious and consistent pattern in the Bible that stories of redemption begin with women in prayer. A couple of days after that sermon, I had a woman thank me for that comment and then proceeded to admit to me the shame she felt for not praying enough, as if that was my point. It wasn't. We should all pray more, my friends. I expect that means you. It certainly means me. My point was not to say something deficient about women. My point was to say something wonderful about God. That God hears the voice of the voiceless. In a world that gives preference to power and privilege, God is inclined to pay attention to the voices that are silenced and abused. Hannah's voice reminds us, before we enter the halls of power, that it is her voice that activates the heart of God. Hannah knows that. about God. She knows. When you listen to her song after Samuel is born, it is clear that she knows that God listens to her voice. This is what she says. There is no holy one like the Lord, no one beside you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. God was listening to Hannah's voice. Someone else was listening too. Eventually, centuries later, Mary, the mother of Jesus, would be listening to Hannah's voice. Her song in Luke chapter 2 is a perfect reflection of Hannah's heart. And is it any wonder? The very last line of Hannah's song, the very last verse, says this: "The Lord, his adversaries shall be shattered. The Most High will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth, and he will give strength to his king and exalt the power of his anointed." The last word in that verse, the last word, is the Hebrew word HaMashiach, or Messiah. In Greek, it is translated Christ. Her son Samuel would anoint two kings to rule in Israel. But Mary knows that they are just placeholders for the king that would come, the king that would reign eternally, the king who would willingly accept the role of servant, the oppressed, the voiceless in the world. Indeed, he would pour out his very life to confer on them a place of honor in his kingdom. Come, Lord. Come and make it so. Amen. Let's stand together and confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and was born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please greet one another this morning with that blessing of peace.
lives. Thank you to the choir as they invite us to praise you. What beautiful, simple message. I invite you to stand at this time as we take time to lay our burdens down, to pray for our church, for the world, for all who are in need in this morning, and for all that you carry in your hearts today. Gracious God, we are grateful for your presence in our lives. May we lean into the humility and grace that we witness in the words and lives of Hannah and Mary. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, we are called to lift up the lowly, to help those living in fear. Today we give thanks for the opportunities to serve, to meet the needs of our neighbors by offering basic human needs such as a home or food or a compassionate presence and kindness. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we pray for our neighbors who have been impacted by recent hurricanes, tornadoes, flooding, for the loss of lives, for the devastation of neighborhoods, and for our neighbors who are living in war zones and living in fear, who are in need of peace and comfort and food and kindness. May those be available to them. May they find care that they need. Lord, in your mercy. God of wisdom, may we hear the voices of all people, that even those who are viewed as less than or the lowly always have a presence in God's eyes and heart. May we be led to be respectful, to let go of arrogance, and that decency always be at the core of who we are called to be. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, you hear all our needs. You know them before we speak them. We're so grateful for your presence. And for that, we give thanks. Amen. And let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And as you go out on this day, go enjoy a beautiful breakfast and celebrate the work and witness of Habitat. But as you go out, carry this message of love with you, with whomever you meet, and may it comfort you always. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.